Hello, gosh, I'm on a roll today. This is my third episode of the day. I'm not going to do another one after this, so it gives me time to read your comments in episodes 4, 5, and this one being 6. So I'll give myself time to start getting that feedback from you guys. So please do use the comments below, good and bad, they're all helpful. I'm not going to do the normal YouTuber thing of subscribe and bell and all that sort of crap because it drives me nuts. You know those things exist. Do it if you want to. Don't if you don't. I'm not monetizing or getting money out of these videos. So yeah. Anyway, enough about that. Here we are, episode 6. We're going to start thinking about actually doing some Wi-Fi stuff. Now we've got this basic class up and running. So, bit of work I've done in between episodes. Firstly, you'll see comments. Yay, comments are very good as long as they are kept up to date and correct. I will be moving to a proper comment structure. At the moment, I've just sort of thrown them in, but I'll keep it consistent with the way the ESP/IDF does comments, the name of which just completely escapes me. Deoxygen, that's it. So that will come in due course, but I'll do that between episodes. That works quite nicely with VS Code when you hover over things. It gives you a bit of talk about, if I find an example, oh, that's a bad one. But it gives you some flavor text. It's nice to use for quick reference. You can see here, this is for one of our methods that we wrote, the get Mac, and you can see in the pop-up here. It gives us a little bit of text about what's going on, and that is this line of text here. But I'll tidy it up and we'll see in due course how useful that can actually be. So in between episodes, just to take you through what I have actually done, I've finalized the mutex type structure I want to use. So we'll use the standard library one. I mentioned at the end of the last episode that it's the one I use least frequently. So something I would like to use a little bit more. So we'll give that a go, see how we get on. We can always come back and change it. And more interestingly, and you'll see in my to-do notes here, anything highlighted YouTube is stuff that is a note to me. So this won't get committed. So I've got rid of the first call flag, because we can actually do it without needing that flag, so we save ourselves a byte. Actually a bit more because it would be an aligned byte, so it would actually be 4 bytes. But anyway, that's all by the by. We can actually do this in a slightly more intelligent way. Again, is it really going to save us any time or any memory? We're talking 1, maybe 4 bytes and 1 or 2 clock cycles. No, in the grand scheme of things, it's going to make no difference at all. The difference will be measurable because it is making a difference, but it's not going to be huge. But what it does do is it cleans up our code a little bit. It gives us one less thing we have to think about. So what's this clever way of doing it? Well, we have our MAC address as a C string, so C string of ASCII characters that's null terminated, so that's a C string. It's static, and we initialize it at the top of our CPP file, and we default initialize it. So that means all of the bytes in that array will be initialized to zero or null or null pointer or whatever zero. So in ASCII terms, that is the null terminator is zero. So we know whether or not this C string holds our MAC address, because it'll hold our MAC address if it's not zeros. and that is zeros in terms of bytes rather than the zero character. So the character zero is not the same as zero. And you can look that up on an ASCII table. So we know if, we might as well just test the very first byte of this, if it is zero, then we know it contains no ASCII characters. And if we try to print that out as a string, we would get nothing printed out because the very first character is null, which is the null terminator. So we don't need the flag, actually, for telling us whether or not we need to call the API function, get the Mac from the default Mac from the eFuses, because, yeah, as I say, we know if it's blank, then we haven't already got it. So that's all I've done here. Don't need that flag anymore. We get our lock, our mutex to start with, so we only progress here if we're the only one executing these lines of code, otherwise we'll sit and wait. And if Mac the value at the first byte is null or zero in terms of bytes, so which is equivalent to false, so i.e. not that, so this then flips and becomes true, then we're going to call our function, our getMac function. Otherwise, if this first character is anything other than null, then this will be true. We then not it, which then makes it false. So just flipping, get that in your head, flipping the logic round, then this won't execute, because we've already got it. We don't need to run that bit of code. So hopefully that explains that bit. So I can get rid of that comment. Got another one here. Okay, constructors and assignment operators. I'm not going to talk about this simply because at the moment, all of them, bar the default constructor, are default. So just to be quite verbose and follow what we call the rule of five, I'm going to include them here because we may actually need to change some of these in due course as this class evolves and starts getting functionality. We may well find that actually we can't do a copy constructor, which would be this one, or we can't do the move constructor, copy assignment or move assignment. So we could then at that point say, well, actually this one, we can't do that, we can't implement it, so we could actually delete it. I won't talk about this. There's a reference there to CPP reference, rule of three, but it also contains in that page the rule of five and the rule of seven as well. So you can read up on it there, or have a look in Jason Turner's C++ Weekly video series. He's done great stuff on default, on constructors, assignment operators, so on and so forth, and he's covered that far better than I ever could. So that'll be the reference there, and if I remember, I will stick a link to his videos there in the description down below. Not related in any way to Jason, but you know, there's, I'm not reinventing the wheel there. He's done a great job, so there's no point me doing it. Couple more. So getting our Mac, so you'll notice the prefix here has changed a little bit more. There's no value in this, so as it was before was this. So we're going to return a const char star, so a pointer to a constant character, and that's just going to return the start of our buffer containing our C string here. This is currently a member function, so it will be implemented for each instance of this class or child. but it doesn't change. This is accessing a static variable, so it makes more sense for this to be static, or it makes sense for this to be static, because then there'll only be one instance of this function, or this method, which has now become a function, because it never changes. So it's perfectly valid to do this, and probably reads a bit better, because then me reading this sees that this function is always going to return the same thing regardless of which instance you are in. So that's good. And because we are returning a static member here, which is assigned at compile time, we know the address in memory that this is going to hold. So actually, we can make this const expert, and it's really, really good practice. And again, Jason Turner in CPP Weekly has done a cracking video on const expert, and why you should use it everywhere you possibly can. Basically, similar to what we talked about in the last video, the more stuff you can offload to the compile process, the better, because then it is less that your embedded system needs to do, which is significantly lower power and lower memory, and less assignments and allocations and so on, and stack frames that your embedded system, in this case our ESP, needs to do at runtime, because it's already done. There's no point. It's going to be the same. We know what it is at compile time, so get your computer, your PC, whatever you're compiling this on, to do it in a fraction of the time and do it once. And it also eliminates some variance as well. So that's why this is const expert and static. By the way, it makes no difference whether this is static const expert, which you'll probably see more commonly, or static, or const expert static. Personally, I prefer this way of doing it, but it makes no difference. And the last thing is, yeah, before, last time you saw this, this get Mac was defined like this, or declared like this. Again, this function, this method, never changes with respect to the instance. So that means it's the same for every instance calling it. So it makes a lot more sense for this to be static, because then it is clear to the reader. Some stuff happens under the hood as well, but we won't delve into that. But to the reader, this now tells me, reading this function definition here, declaration here. God, I will never get those the right way around. Anyway, it tells me that this is the same for every instance. So it's good for me visually. So that's the housekeeping done. Right, cool. Okay, move on. So what we're going to look at then is properly initializing the Wi-Fi driver. And to do that, first of all, in our CMake lists, we've already got ESP Wi-Fi, NVS Flash, and ESP Event, ESP NetIF, and LWIP. So we've already got our things included in our CMake environment. So that's good. They're going to get linked and compiled correctly. We've already included ESP Wi-Fi. So we need to include a couple of other bits and bobs. And I'm following the example in the IDF for this, for setting up a Wi-Fi station. We won't do access point just now. So we will include ESP, is it NetIF? No, that's included by ESP Wi-Fi now, I think. Didn't used to be. so we'll include ESP event.h, because we need that. And we'll include NVS Flash, because the Wi-Fi driver needs that. We'll include ESP log, because that'll be useful when we actually flash this to a device to get some useful output. And that will be it for now. Yes, we'll be coming back to this to add more stuff in as and when we need it. So, some of the housekeeping. Okay, NVS Flash. Now, this is where it's going to be hard to decouple. The Wi-Fi driver requires that the non-volatile store of information is initialized before the Wi-Fi driver is initialized. Now, we could do that in our constructor, and we could put a guard around it because it only needs to happen once. But the thing is, other stuff, other modules that we have are going to need the non-volatile to have been initialized as well. And we don't really want to be calling it over and over again. So you can imagine our Wi-Fi is going to call the init. We might have, you know, three or four other modules that are all calling NVS init. And we really don't need, nor necessarily want to do that. So unfortunately, the only way to get around that is to initialize it outside of the scope of the modules. Now, thankfully, the NVS stuff is used by so many different things that actually it's perfectly valid, in my opinion, to do this outside. Oh, and we've already done it, so we've probably talked about this previously. So in our app main, this happens before anything else happens. We initialize the init, and only after that happens and it's error checked to make sure that, yep, good things happened, then we initialize our user code. So by putting this line in here, right in the app main, what we can do is we can guarantee that the non-volatile flash has been initialized before we come into our Wi-Fi implementation. So actually, we don't need the NVS stuff. And this is where we'll diverge ever so slightly from the example code in the IDF, because we've already done it in our app main. And actually, if you look at the example code, they also do it in their app main. So let's stick with that modus operandi, I guess. Sorry, our way of doing things for you non-English speakers. Okay, so there's a couple of things we need to do. First of all, we need an init function. So we have an init function here. At the moment, we have declared this as a member function. There's some stuff that we only want to do once, calling the API initialization routines. We only want to do that once. But there'll be other things that we want to do for each time we create one of these objects, additional to the API stuff. So we're going to need another function. Yes, function, because it'll be static and we'll follow normal naming convention of private stuff should start with an underscore and init. And for the moment, this will just take no parameters. And that will return some sort of error or ESP OK if all is good. Now we need to be able to keep track of our state. So we define this strongly typed enum, so it's an enum class. And we've got these various different states, so not initialized, which is how we will start up, initialized, waiting for credentials, blah, blah, so on and so forth. But we don't actually have a variable to hold this yet. I've put one in here. This is going to be global, not global, wrong terminology. This is going to be static because it's referring to the state of the API. So whether or not we are initialized, waiting for credentials, ready to connect, connecting, so on and so forth, this will be our state with respect to the API. So this needs to be static. And you'll see that we'll be using a lot of static stuff. And because this is static, we also need to initialize it outside here. States, so we'll do Wi-Fi, and then we'll do brace initialization. State E doesn't exist, but it does exist inside the scope of our class, so we'll put that in there. I'll tidy up this indentation, something like that. There we go, looks a bit prettier. And then we're going to initialize into the not initialized state, which doesn't make a huge amount of sense, but anyway. And because it's a strongly typed enum, we need to give it the scope. Is it going to be happy with that? Yes, it is. So within the scope of states underscore e, which is what we've defined here, you could just do this as a normal enum and then you don't need that. And the compiler will assign likely 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. But it doesn't really make sense for these to be numbers. So we'll leave it as a strongly typed enum. It makes it more clear and saves any potential bugs down in the future. It means you can't increment it. And so on. Okay, cool. So we initialize into the not initialized state. So we need to create our static init function that's going to call the API calls that we only need to do once. So let's do that. Let's get rid of that one. Let's get rid of that one. So let's do our init function here. Okay. Now then, we only want to run this once, assuming it works, and we only want to run it once at a time as well. So, and we now know how to do this, we need to prevent multiple objects trying to call this function at once at the same time. As I say, we know how to do that, and using the quite nice standard library way of doing things, we just need to do that, and all the scoping and releasing and so on is done for us, which is really, really nice thing about RAII, which we talked about in the last episode, so I won't go into depth now. And now we need to check whether or not we need to initialize. So basically, we only need to initialize if our state is currently not initialized. So if state's not initialized is equal to our current state, which is underscore state, then we need to do some initialization. Otherwise, we'll assume we're all good, and return out of this function. So let's declare ourselves our return value. We'll call it status. We'll initialize it to some sort of known variable, to known value, sorry. And then at the end of the function, we'll return status. Okay, so that's just fairly standard. That's what we're going to return. Now then, there's one case where we are not in this state that we might not want to return ESP OK. VS Code's doing its laggy thing again. I might need to do a reinstall. And that case is if we are in the error state. So that's the only time when we would want to return from this initialization static function anything other than what actually happened, and that's if we're in this error state. So we're going to put another branch on here. I've been doing Python again. Else if, so if our state, if we are currently in an error state, we're just going to stay in that state, or likely to. We can always come back and change this. then our status is going to be ESP fail. Because we don't want to return and say we're initialized or everything went well with initialized if we're in this error state. We need to do something else. So what you can see here is if we are initialized or in any of these other states waiting for credentials, which means we must be initialized, connected, waiting for IP, we must be initialized, then we're going to return ESP OK, because this won't execute. Well, sorry, this will, but this won't. That'll fail, so this won't execute. So we'll just return ESP OK. So that means we can call this regardless of, you know, what's previously happened. We can safely call it because we've got a mutex. And if it returns ESP OK, then everything is golden. And that's a really sort of nice way of doing things. It's a way I like, so. So let's actually start doing the tings. And again, following the example in the IDF, so you can use this at home as well and see what I'm doing. I'm going to implement it in a slightly different way. But it's reasonably similar, mainly because I don't like the ESP error check macro. So the first API call we need to make is to initialize the netif. So that's the network interface, as Espressif are calling it. And it's this call here. And we can see if we hover over that, it's returning an error type. So let's keep track of this, and we can do something like that. Good. Now, we got a decision to make. Was that successful, or was it not successful? We need to check that, because there's no point in us now trying to initialize the next thing if the netif was not initialized itself. Everything's going to break and it'll get its knickers in a twist. Best case scenario. Worst case scenario is it will actually progress, think things are initialized, and you're in the realms of undefined behavior. Then we don't know what's going to happen. Bad things, probably. The next API call we want then is ESP netif create default Wi-Fi station, and this will return whatever this netif type is. So we can quite easily do this. We'll just give it a name. Oops, caps lock. And this is a star, so this is a pointer, so we'll have a default notation there. And this is probably going to be constant. It's not going to change, and it's going to be a const pointer as well, i.e. we're not going to increment this pointer. It might transpire that we don't need this at all, in which case we don't need to save it, so we can just get rid of it altogether. But we only want to call this if this was successful. So, unfortunately, more branching. And you'll see this line very, very regularly now. So if the status is ESP OK, i.e. this was successful, then we're going to do this bit. How do we know if this was successful? Well, this will be successful if it returns anything but a null pointer. That is what I would assume. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to Google that function, have a quick look-see at the notes, and we'll have a look. Yeah, so this returns a pointer to the netif instance. In case of an init error, this API calls an abort. So actually, we probably don't really care about this return value. But let's be complete. Things may change in the future. So because this isn't returning a status, an ESP error type, we're going to have to manually construct that. And the only way we can do this is basically checking whether or not this is null pointer. So if it returns a null pointer, then we've not got an instance of the netif. So something's clearly gone wrong. Now, according to these notes in the API guide, that shouldn't happen. It should call an abort. But on the off chance it does return and returns a null, so nothing was created, we should probably check for that. So if not pnetif, so if this returns a null pointer, status equals ESP fail. And I'm just going to use ESP fail for the time being. Again, we can come in and change these to different errors as we see fit. And that's all we need to do for that particular bit. So what's the next bit? Next bit is we need to create a default configuration for the actual Wi-Fi itself. So we've done it for the interface, now we actually need to do it for this Wi-Fi instance. So I'm just going to copy and paste a line in here. And again, we're going to wrap this, and I'm not saying this is the best way of doing it, but it is a way of doing it. So if we were successful initializing, we'll create the default Wi-Fi station in the network interface. And if we were successful doing that, we're going to create a default config. And you can see if I hover over this, this is just a macro. So initialize a structure, this Wi-Fi init config type. Because this is written in C, it's a bit harder to do initialization and so on. So they've done it the C way with a macro. And then we are going to initialize to that config. So this is going to return a struct, so it's not a pointer, so we don't need to check this exists. But then we're going to call ESP Wi-Fi init, and we are going to pass it a pointer to this default configuration that we've just created. If we hover over this, it's returning an error type, so that's really handy. We can assign that to our status variable, which means if this fails, so this returns anything other than ESP OK, then that is what will get returned by this entire function. So we can actually track it, print it out, see what went on, so on and so forth. And we can put some debug messages in here later down the line if we see fit. Now, can anyone see something that might be interesting here? And it's a question around scope. So we're initializing the Wi-Fi in the API with this configuration. I don't know what happens inside this, but what I can see is we're passing it a pointer. It would be safe to assume, unless told otherwise, that then the Wi-Fi driver is going to be accessing that pointer and the data held within it. But the problem is, as soon as we leave this scope, because this was created on the stack inside these squiggly brackets, as soon as we hit here, that memory is no longer valid. It's gone. It's been deconstructed. It's been gone. It's very unsafe to start accessing this pointer now. It's still there within this function, could be held within the Wi-Fi driver itself. I don't know, I've not looked at the implementation, and to be honest, I don't really care. But I'm going to assume, because it's taken, particularly because it's taken a pointer, that it's probably going to be using it later down the line. but it can't use it, because as soon as we hit this line here, then that memory doesn't exist anymore. All these parameters, it doesn't exist. So we've got to be very, very careful. So how can we get around this? Well, quite simply, we need to save this value, this structure, this Wi-Fi init config, so that it is valid throughout the lifetime of when we are using Wi-Fi. So we could be really, really crude and just make this locally static. So that means it will persist beyond the lifetime of this function. And actually, because it's static, it will persist forever until we reboot. That's a bit janky, and I don't like that way of doing it. It's going to be eating up some resources. That's probably not really the problem here. It's more a problem around, well, what if you want to change this config and reinitialize stuff? Well, now it becomes very hard because you've got no way of modifying this and sending a new config. So there's a better way of doing this. And really, that is just making it a member variable. And that's exactly what we're going to do. And this will be private because we don't want anyone else changing it. Only ourselves. And let's call it Wi-Fi config. And let's go to the top where our statics are. Oh, that's annoying, the length of that type. Anyway, Wi-Fi config. And are we going to default initialize it? Well, no, there's no point. We might as well give it the default config and initialize it to that. And this will happen at compile time. So we don't need to spend any resources at runtime populating this structure and assigning all the bytes and everything. We can do that now. So that's what we'll do. So this Wi-Fi config is going to contain the default config, unless we change it later down the line, and only we can change it. So that's really good. So now I can get rid of that line altogether, and I can pass it this config here, and we're passing it pointer, so by address, should I say. So it's the and. And we know on top of that that this will persist at least as long as our entire Wi-Fi implementation persists. Actually, it'll exist indefinitely because it's static, but it's going to outlive everything else. And that's important in case the driver is using the values in there beyond this line of code. So that's something you got to watch, scope and validity of addresses and so on. There is a very good chance that if this did try and access it, we hadn't implemented it like that, that it may actually succeed, and it will just be accessing at this point a random byte and whatever value that currently is at that address, and it won't be right. That's if we're unlucky. If we're lucky, the program will crash and say, no, you shouldn't be accessing this byte. It's not what you thought it was. It's been freed, deleted, got rid of. That's if you're lucky. It will abort at runtime and you'll get a segmentation fault. If you're unlucky, it will work, but do something completely unexpected. So yeah, something to watch out for. Okay. Actually, I'm going to change the naming of this Wi-Fi init config. So let's just update that. So that's our Wi-Fi init config. There we go. Just update the naming. Why? Well, because the next function call we've got, and again, we're going to wrap it in if ESP OK equals status, because there's no point executing this if something up here failed. And this one, we need to set the actual config. And to set the config, we actually need to have a config. And I'm going to copy this in from the example. And then we'll go through it together. Okay, so let's tidy up and make things a bit more consistent. So this is using the old C way of doing dot initialization of members within this structure. There's some flavor text there if we want it. And there's some information here, which we'll get rid of because we don't need that. Okay. So what are we setting here? Let's have a look. So we are setting, first of all, that we are a Wi-Fi station. We're setting the SSID, the password, the authentication mode, PMF config. I have no idea what that is, but anyway, they're doing it. But this is the old C way of doing it. And again, what's contained within here? Well, it's something that we are passing to the driver, and this is going to go out of scope very, very quickly. And there's a good chance that it's going to need your SSID and password later. Say we disconnect because the router drops offline and comes back, and it goes, oh, the router's back, I now need to reconnect. And all of a sudden, well, what's this pointing to? We have no idea. This value could have been overwritten by something else. How's it going to get the SSID and password? We don't know. It might be doing a mem copy under the hood or something and storing it locally. We just don't know. So again, we're going to keep this within our construct, so we know for sure that it's going to exist, and it's just like we did before. We'll make it static, and it's going to be our Wi-Fi config, not a Wi-Fi init config, but our Wi-Fi config this time around. So let's do that. Let's do some indentation. Let's put Wi-Fi to get the scope correct, and we will default initialize this. Okay. Now, I would really, really like to get rid of this dot stuff for defining parameters. You'll probably get a warning from your compiler about this, that this isn't C++ code. If you're doing this in C, it's perfectly fine. Actually, C++ will do it as well. It just doesn't like it, and it throws warnings at you. And we don't want to have warnings if we can get away with it. So, but we do need to set some of this data, some of this interesting stuff here. Now we can argue where we should be setting this stuff, but I'm going to do it in this within this scope, and because we're setting it in something that's static, that will persist. So what do we call it? Wi-Fi config. So the way we can do this, Wi-Fi config dot, and then we can read off what's going on here. So dot STA dot SSID. Let's just put a semicolon there for the moment. And is this gonna play nicely, or am I gonna have to? Yeah, I'm gonna have to F12 into this. So F12, F12 again. And let's have a look at what this structure is. Ah, okay, good. I'm glad I did that. So the structure is actually containing a buffer. So 64 bytes for the password, 32 for the SSID. Interesting that they're UN8s and not chars. I wonder if it requires these to be null terminated or not. Don't know, so we'll assume yes, because it won't do any harm. But first of all, let's just get our stuff in that we need to do. Password, because it looks like we're gonna have to do some mem copying here. And dot threshold dot auth mode. Well, that's a constant, so we can put that one in already. That's nice and easy to do. Yep, that's going to get reassigned each time we call this, which isn't ideal. But remember, we've got a lock on this, and we're only calling this if we're in the non-initialized state anyway. So it's not that big of a deal. So let's just copy and paste this. PMF config, whatever that is. And dot capable equals true. Realistically, I'd be looking at these and trying to figure out what they do. In fact, PMF config. Config for protected management frames will be advertised. Oh, okay. Yeah, this is new. So advertises support for protected management frames. Device will connect in PMF mode, prefer to connect, if the other device also advertises that it's capable. Oh, okay, I see. All right, well that's new stuff. That's pretty cool. So we can advertise that we can do it now, but required, no, we're more than happy doing it old way. If the other device doesn't support it, in this case our router, and that's absolutely fine. Okay, cool. So that's the information we need to set. So these three are done, these two are not. And these contain buffers, not pointers. And that's quite important. So it means we need to copy our SSID and our password into these buffers, which then gets passed down here. And let's just update that. So what is our SSID and password? Well, yeah, I'm not going to tell you what it is, what mine is, but I will be setting up something that we can connect to, you know, with sort of username and password and that sort of stuff. But for the time being, what I'm going to do is, hang on, if I can do this correctly, we'll do it the C++ way rather than hash defines. Const expert static char, it's a const char star. We'll do SSID and we'll do password. Oops. And this will be my Wi-Fi SS ID, just for argument's sake. And this will be my Wi-Fi password. Okay, so these are const expert because this can be evaluated at compile time. They're static, so it's the same for every instance. And they are const char stars that will contain or point to this string, null terminated string, somewhere in memory. Don't care where it is, that's fine. But what this means we can do, or what we can't do, is equals SSID equals password. This is bad. Okay, it may let us do this, but I'm not even going to entertain the idea because these are actually buffers, they're not pointers. So it's the it's not that, it's one of these. So we actually need to copy our data into this buffer. And simple way of doing that is to do a mem copy. And I always forget which header mem copies in. I think it's in string. Yes, it is. So we will include hash include, and we'll tidy our includes up later down the line. So C string, because this is a C library that has memcopy in it. And what we're going to do is we are going to memcopy to this address our SSID, and the length of it is size of, this poses a question. Let's think about this, because there's something to talk about here. That, and then we're going to do the same thing for password. And then we'll talk about what's happening, then we'll talk about the problem. So these two are invalid, so let's get rid of them. So we're going to copy into this buffer, which is that 32 byte buffer here, whatever is held at this address, which is my Wi-Fi SSID here. How many bytes are we going to copy? Well, we're going to copy the number of bytes that this holds, because we're doing size of that thing. And because that's an array, that size of is 32 in this case, and for password it's 64. So it'll copy that. So what's the problem? Well, the problem is it's going to read 32 bytes from here and copy them into here. Copying them into here is no problem because this is 32 bytes long. So that bit's not a problem. And same here for 64 bytes here. The problem is this. What is held at this address? Because we are going to read 32 bytes from there. Well, what's held there is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, plus the null terminator, so 11 bytes. And then the next byte, I have no idea what that is. And it's going to read another 21 bytes and copy them in. And they make no sense. We don't know what they are. Now, in reality, it's going to be the start of this. But it, you know, it becomes a problem because we're copying in memory that we shouldn't be accessing here. We don't know what it is. We've only got this number of bytes. Okay. Well, let's do it a different way then. Let's think of this a different way. Let's do the number of characters in our password. In our SSID. So we use string len SSID and string len password. So now what's it going to do? Well, we're still copying into the same place and from the same place, but it's going to be the number of characters in this SSID string. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's 10 characters. So it's going to copy 10 characters into a buffer that can hold up to 32. Okay, well, that sounds pretty good. We've default initialized this, so the 11th character will be a null terminator in that buffer. So that's good. Until we change the SSID and weird stuff will happen then. So that's not ideal. But can you see what the problem is with this way of doing it? At the moment, it's fine. But what if my SSID is massive and it is more than 32 characters here? Could very easily copy in something, you know, huge. This could be not a static const char. This could be coming from something else. I don't know, over Bluetooth, you're setting your Wi-Fi, SSID and password, and it goes wrong and gives you, you know, 50 odd characters there. So what's it going to do? Well, this is now, for argument's sake, say 50 characters. It's going to try and copy in 50 characters. It'll read 50, and that's fine because this is 50 long. And it's going to copy them into this buffer, which is 32 long. R. So bytes 33, 34, 35, 36, we don't have access to. And likely what it'll be is it's going to start overwriting memory and the password, and then the SSID length, and blah, 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 blah. That's going to cause us a problem. Real, real problem. So what we need to do is copy in however many characters we've got for the SSID up to a maximum of however big this buffer is. And it would make sense, actually, if the SSID we're given is longer than the one the driver can support, then clearly we're not going to get the full SSID in. So regardless of what the standard says about SSIDs can only be 32 characters long anyway, it doesn't really matter in this instance. We know if our SSID is too long, then we can't copy it in. So how can we do this? So there's a number of different tools, I guess, we can do. I guess the easiest one to start with is to just do a max. So we can use the standard algorithm header, or you can write your own for this, for a max function. It's very, very simple. I'll show you both. Conscious that we're just about hitting the hour mark here. So what we can do is standard max of the string length and the size of this buffer. Size of, doesn't matter the order of these two, that. And imagine we're doing the same for password. I'll just nudge that down a bit because it doesn't matter. It's going to be the same. So what's this doing? We're going to read in the length of our SSID in the number of characters, and we're going to read in the size of this buffer, which is 32. And we'll return... Oh, sorry, it's not max, is it, idiot? It's min. We want the minimum. So if the SSID is shorter, then we only need to copy in that number of bytes. We don't want to overrun. And equally, if the buffer we're copying it to is smaller, then we don't want to copy in more bytes than it can hold. And that's a very crude way of doing it. Now, it would imply from this structure that this doesn't need to be null terminated because it's not holding a char. Oh, and we've got SSID length here. Yeah. Okay, so one way we could implement this then is we would then set our SSID length. I'm assuming how this works, so let's just copy that in. Sorry for the tab flipping here. Is equal to the standard min of this, because that's the number of bytes we've just copied in. And that this makes perfect sense. Now we can actually just simplify this slightly and do it the other way round. We don't need to call standard min twice. We've already called it once and got the value, so we can then just use the value. Got enough brackets there? Yeah, cool. So we set the SSID length to the minimum, whichever's smaller, of the size of our SSID or the size of the buffer. And then we use that value and copy those number of bytes over. And we would do the same for the password. Still doesn't handle the case where if our SSID is longer than what this buffer can hold, then clearly the driver's not going to work because we're going to get a truncated SSID string. Now, under the hood, that might actually work. I don't know. But it would make much more sense to me to return a fail because we've tried to set an SSID that is clearly too long, doesn't fit in the 32 bytes. Therefore, clearly it's wrong. Therefore, it makes no sense initializing it. Initializing ourselves to use bad data. So really, what I would want to do here is... many ways of doing this. You could crudely say if string length SSID is greater than the size of the buffer we're copying it into, then return ESP error invalid argument. In fact, no, actually, that would be... Now let's just do ESP fail for the time being. Now, the reason why I don't particularly like that is because we've got a return statement in the middle of a function, and that can get a little bit hard to wrap your head around when stuff is firing all over the place. It's much cleaner to have one return point, or at least them all clustered in the same place. So when you come back to this in a few months' time, you know, you're not going, well, why is it not executing this line of code? And it's because you had a sneaky return statement up here. So we could do this somewhere else, of course. It would probably make sense. Let's say it would make sense to me to do this in the constructor the way we've currently got it. So because these are static const expers, let's just make that sensible again. We could actually just check these in our constructor. But what I want to do is think forward. We might not know what these are at compile time, because we might be setting them over Bluetooth, for example, you know, deploying this out to somewhere at work or at home, and you want the ability to set your Wi-Fi password without having to reflash your ESP, because that would be really inconvenient, having to rip it out of wherever it's deployed, plug in a USB cable, recompile, flash it, blah, blah, blah. So maybe we don't know these at compile time. So what would be a good way of checking this here and returning some sort of fail message? That's your homework. In the interest of completeness, let us just finish this off, and then I can commit it, push it up, and then you've got the data there, the commit there, to use as your reference. Now, password length, I don't believe, is in here. No, it's not. So, oh, poop. Password. So very same thing, but this time string length of password, and this will be 64. That's evaluated at compile time. In fact, this is const expert, so this is probably all going to be evaluated at compile time. But we can't save it to here. That makes no sense. So the password length to copy. Oh, and we'll just make this size type. I know that's gone off the edge, but you know what it's saying. And this is const. We're not going to change it. Oh, blimey. So let's make it const. And then we're going to copy that number of bytes. So we can just overwrite that there. So now we evaluate, find the number of bytes we're going to copy, which is the minimum of the SSID length we've given it and the number of bytes that we can hold. And then we copy that in. And then we do the same for the password, the minimum of the length of the password and the size we can hold, and copy that number of bytes in. Is there a better way of doing this? Food for thought. We'll talk about it a bit more next time, and dive a bit deeper into the high level. We're doing this very bottom up at the moment, but realistically we need to think about the application and how we're going to get this information in, and it's not going to be like this. We're going to use something a little bit more intelligent and user-friendly to copy all that in. So let me just sort out, make this look a little bit prettier. Something like that. And some people don't like it when I do this. I must say I'm on the fence. But I'm massively zoomed in here, so feel free to undo that. Doesn't change anything. And then we set that config in here, something like that. So let's just quickly check that this actually compiles and I've not been talking a load of rubbish. And haha, we have an error. That's good. So what are we missing? State A has not been declared. Hang on. So I'm going to leave this sort of debugging stuff in because hopefully it'll be useful for you. I've got a feeling I'm missing a bracket somewhere. It's giving me those vibes. Wi-Fi is not declared. Oh, does it not like me doing that? No, because that's list initialization. Yeah. Okay, that's because this is a macro. Let's give that another go. So we need to use assignment here, rather than squiggly brackets, which is a list initializer. And okay, different error. Let's chew through this. So has no member named SSID length. I beg to differ. So hang on, what's the struct we're copying this into? So let's go through this. So it's the Wi-Fi config type, which is this. It's the Wi-Fi station config, so that's .sta, yeah, which goes to this. Oh. Ah. Oh, that's weird. So if you're configuring this as an access point, you can give it an SSID length, but if you're configuring it as a Wi-Fi station, you can't. Huh. That's weird. Oh god, they're doing bit feels down here. Okay. So I wonder if these do need to be null terminated then. You would probably assume not. Alright, well let's just fix it first and then we'll think about it. So it's not really much of an issue. We've just got to have this variable local. Well, this constant local as it actually is. And we can make that one line. So let's just make it work first. And then we'll think about null terminating this. Okie dokie, initializing argument one of Wi-Fi set config. Oh, they've changed the API and they've not changed. Well, they have changed the example. I'm just being a dimwit. So this call is slightly different. So we set Wi-Fi station there. And interestingly, they've actually got another API call, which seems superfluous. But let's quickly put it in. So if ESP OK equals equals status, then status equals, and this ESP Wi-Fi set mode, Wi-Fi mode station. Now we're setting that as a constant here. We probably want to keep track of that and have knowledge of it. So we'll think about that next time. Yeah, let's not worry about it for now. So to do keep track of mode, and then that comment is actually echoed down here really. Okay, so let's do that. So that's a bit more complete. We're up to line 107 inclusive in the station example main, if you're following along with the IDF example there. Chugga chugga chugga, and we've got down to the linker, so I'm feeling a little bit more confident, and there we go. Cool, so we've done a bit of compile time bug fixing here as well. So what I want you guys to do and have a think about is how we could better do this. Particularly don't like this memcopy in there. It's safe, but what happens if it's not null terminated, so on? Well, we want to change the password. How can we handle that? And yeah, down below in the comments, I'll give it a couple of days between now when this video comes out, and doing the next video, so I have time to digest your comments and thoughts, and then we'll implement what you think and what I think as well. So hope you enjoyed. Until next time, ta-ta.